Back in the 1920s, there was a fellow by the name of Ace Corben who designed an airplane that he called the Baby Ace. And it was a parasol-type airplane, single seat, and it became a real hit. It's a cute little airplane. And sometime around in there, he decided to build a cabin version of the Baby Ace. Now, the little single place cabin, Corben Cabin Ace, it's a cute little airplane, but it didn't catch on like the Baby Ace did for some reason. I'm really not sure. Other than the drawings, I mean, they really weren't a good set of drawings for this airplane, and I'll show you them in a moment. It gives you some dimensions, but leaves a lot to be desired. These airplanes were powered with a three-cylinder Seike. Now, that's what I've heard it's called. A lot of people call it a Zeekly or a Zeke, but I think the proper pronunciation for that little engine is Seike, and it's 190 cubic inches, but I think it only puts out around 30 or 32 horsepower, but it did a fair job with this airplane. Now, this airplane was the forerunner to the Baby Ace Jr. Now, this is a cabin version of the Baby Ace Jr. You know what? I'm not sure if there ever was a Baby Ace Jr. that was open cockpit. I really need to look into that. But anyway, this is the cabin version, the two-place side-by-side. It's a chunky little airplane. There's one around in Texas somewhere. I saw it at an air show, a fly-in. It's a pretty cute little airplane, and you can buy drawings from the people that own the rights to the Baby Ace. I've got a set of those drawings, but it's not built anything like the single-place Cabin Ace. Now, this airplane is a copy that my old mentor Bob Rowe built back in the 1970s, and this picture is in a 1973 copy of Sport Aviation. Bob took the drawings that were published in what was called a builder's manual, and then he did a lot of interpolation and trying to figure out what the dimensions were on that fuselage, and he built this airplane. It's powered with a Continental 75, and it did a great job. Now, these drawings were found in a 1957 publication put out by the EAA called the Builder's Manual. And I don't think you can get that Builder's Manual anymore. I've had this one forever. But it shows how the little cabin Corben was built. Now, the Corben Jr., that fuselage is built very similar to a Baby Ace, but then the cabin portion, the turtleback, was built out of plywood and fared in. Now, this is all 4130 chromoly. Of course, back in those days, I guess they were using 1025 mild steel. But the dimensions leave a lot to be desired. They give you quite a few dimensions. Let's look at a bigger version of this. In these drawings, they give quite a few measurements, but they're all longitudinally. And the only measurement that they give you in this dimension is a center line to the center line or the thrust line of the fuselage. And they don't give you anything else. There's nothing to indicate what these are, those measurements are. So there's going to be a lot of interpolation trying to figure all of that out. And I don't have the notes that Bob Rowe had when he built his. I guess that was something that got lost when he passed away. So anyway, the drawings are just very basic. It's more like an artist's conception of what the airplane looked like. And it gives the dimensions for the tail. Let's see. The horizontal stabilizer and the rudder is in there somewhere. There it is. Rudder's back over there. And it gives you a few details here, there, and yonder, but it leaves a lot to interpolation and trying to figure it out on your own. Now, we have a original 1954 set of drawings for the Baby Ace. And the wing on the Corben Cabin Ace is virtually the same as the open cockpit Baby Ace. These drawings were drawn by Stan, I guess it's Zick, D-Z-I-K. I never knew how to pronounce his name even back in the day. And you can see they're approved by Paul Poperesny. But the date on this drawing is 9/4/1954. So I was 4 months old when these drawings were published. Now on these drawings, they give a really thorough rundown on what the dimensions are all the way around that rib. And they also supplied a full-size drawing, but just like any full-size drawing you get with a set of drawings that you may have if you get a Pete and Paul or what have you, and it may have a full set of or a full-scale wing rib, you better go in there and check it, because that paper tends to shrink and the dimensions don't always pan out to be totally correct. Now, the lines on this particular full-size drawing are pretty light, and the poor old drawing is just tattered and old. It almost comes apart when you just touch it. But I've measured it, and it's off quite a bit in length and in other areas. So what I'm going to do is, from a center line, I am going to draw out all of the dimensions onto this rib jig board, and we're going to build a rib jig for the Corben Cabin Ace wing and build some ribs. So before you start laying out dimensions and all of that, you need to take your straight edge and make sure that straight edge is absolutely straight. And this one is. So we've lucked out. You'd be surprised at how many straight edges kind of have a bow in them. Now, for the sake of time, I've already laid the drawing out on this piece of wood. Now, what I use, I love to use this stuff because it's extremely stable. And it's usually very, it's not warped or anything like that. It's called melamine. I believe that's how they pronounce it. You can buy it at Lowe's. You know, I think this is a 7-foot piece by 1 foot, and it's just great stuff to make wing ribs or rib jigs out of. So I laid the the drawing out and made sure it was absolutely straight. And so now that I know that it is, I'm going to lay down some weights to hold that. Let me make sure that's absolutely right. Now, when you put your drawing down on your jig board, you need to take real pain in making sure that it's on there straight. And usually, if you're using a Clark Y airfoil like this, well, I think this is, yeah, this is the Clark Y, you'll have the bottom of the rib or the bottom of the drawing that you can get a straight edge off of. But on other ribs, you may have to get your straight edge from the center of the leading edge back to the center of the trailing edge and work your dimensions off of that. It just depends on how your drawings are dimensioned. And we're going to go along there. Now, I am making a copy of this. You can probably see I've got carbon paper here. Then I've got some paper down underneath here that I'm going to get a tracing of the airfoil onto, and then more carbon paper, and it's going to put an accurate carbon tracing of the airfoil back onto our jig board. Next thing we're going to do is locate the center line of the nose. And they have that. Now let's see, they're showing that to be 1 7/16 up. And that is 1 7/16, so we're going to locate that line. Now some of these dimensions are accurate, but it wanders off by the time you get to the first spar. It's off by probably an eighth of an inch. Going to locate, or we're going to mark our dimensions right there on our jig board. Now we're going to take pain to make sure that this is as accurate as we can possibly get it. Now this drawing says that we come back 3/4 inch. And from here, let's measure that first. It's 1 1/8, and it is, and the top of it up here is 3 inches. Let's see if that measures out, and it does. We're going to mark that 3 inches. This is 1 1/8. And you do this all the way down. And by the time you get through, you will have spent a couple of hours doing this. I'll go ahead and show this so that you can see how far off the dimensions get by the time we get to the front spar. I go to the master drawing with the dimensions, and I see that we go back 1 inch, 1 inch, 1 inch, 1 inch, 1 inch. So that's going to be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we're going to mark that. And already it's a 16th off right there. Now that particular line fell right where it's supposed to. And it's starting to wander off again. Okay, from here, see, we go back 1.5 inches to the center line of the spar. So we go back 1.5 inches from this point to the center line of the spar, 1.5 inches according to this drawing. And you can see, now here's the drawn out spar right there. You can see that the center line is really way back. So that spar is not in the correct position. Unless this dimension on the master drawing is not right, and I need to double check that with another drawing. And that is correct according to another drawing I just looked at. So we're going to draw that center line with our square. Going to measure up 5 3/4 to the top of the rib, and 1, 2, 3, it's right on there, 5 3/4. So we're doing pretty good there. Okay, so far it's coming right along and measuring out. And every time you measure, get a measurement, put a tick mark. Now, there is one dimension that's way off. And this one here says 8 inches to the center line. That's got to be a misprint, because it's actually about 8 3/16. So we'll keep on going and see if it still falls in line with the dimensions that are shown. Okay, this dimension is showing to be 4 5/8. And that is 1, 2, 3, 4. That's right on the money. So that nose is following right on along. So it's working out so far. We've got two more dimensions to go. And we'll see how it goes from there. And by the same token, we want to get measurements from the straight line, the straight edge up to the bottom of the nose. This one is 1/8. It's right. tick mark there. This one is 3/16. And it's right on the money. So, on and on it goes. Just be redundant to keep showing you. I'll come in every now and then and put some video up as it goes along. So we're coming down to the trailing edge, and I have found several mistakes in the drawings. For instance, this right here shows on this drawing to be 2 and 2.5. And up on this drawing, it shows to be 2 3/4. Well, at 2.5, it comes way down too low. And 2 3/4, it's coming right on up in line with the other tick marks. So we're probably, well, 1/4 inch longitudinally out so far. And it right there to 2 1/4 out. So let's see, come out 3 inches. You cannot trust the paper drawing. You've just got to go back. I don't care what it is. Now, you may get lucky, and man, I hope you do. And your paper drawing, the measurements just are dead nuts on. That would be great. But it's been my experience that they're going to be off. And so be sure and go back and check all of that. Okay, let's see. This is going to be 2 inches. And it's pretty close right there. To get a batten and bring it over here and take a look at this. Well, I think I can do it with a straight edge, maybe. Let's see. See, that doesn't look like it's right on there either. Yep, that's right. It's looking good. Okay. Curves right on down there. That's great. So we'll put our tick mark right there. 2 inches. And we will shortly have all of this longitudinally and laterally, all of the measurements down. And then we can go back and start putting in the uprights and diagonals. Well, this last measurement will tell the tale. We're supposed to have a 54-inch cord. 47, 48, 950, 1, 2, 3, 54. It's right dead on it. Oh, perfect. Man, that is perfect. Okay. Well, I'm satisfied with the measurements now. What we could do is put a batten up there and go ahead and draw in the top cap strip. And one way you can do that is to get small nails, and everywhere you've got a tick mark, drive a nail down in there, all the way around, and then lay in your, well, a piece of cap strip. You could use that. Lay it in and draw that top cap strip line in. Now that we've got all of our dimensions laid out and we've double checked it, we're going to go along and connect the dots, connect the lines with the quarter inch batten, or whatever you want to call it, a ship's batten, I think they called it. I'm not really sure. But a flexible piece of wood or what have you, to curve around there and connect the dots, and then we'll put in the upright and diagonal pieces. And as we can see, I've already filled in this area and most of this up here. We just need to do a little more back there towards the rear. And this can get kind of awkward if you're doing it by yourself. I'm just following our outside line and our tick marks. I'm picking those up. That's about the end of that. So now we can go along and fill in our uprights and our diagonals. Okay, now we can come in here and measure out our quarter inch uprights. And what we're going to do is go all the way down the rib and draw in our uprights. And we're going to find the center line on each and every one of these uprights. So every one of the center lines are going to be an eighth of an inch, and we're going to depict that with a little tick mark. And you'll see why in a little bit. Okay, now I'm going to go along and add the rest of the uprights according to this drawing's dimensions. Okay, our first upright past the spar, past the front spar, is 6 3/4 back, and then 7, and then another 7-inch dimension, and then an 8 7/8 to the rear spar. Now, what's funny about this is they make their measurements, and I don't know why they did this. I guess it was a 1954 thing. Usually, you'll make your measurements from center line to center line, but they're making their measurements from the back face to the back face, and so that's what we're going to do. Okay, 6 3/4 to the back side. Take pain to get a absolute 90 degree vertical. And that's correct. Now, as you're laying out the center lines and the thickness of your cap strips, don't let that be gospel. It's really going to be dependent on your cap strips, where you buy your cap strips from. If you buy it from Aircraft Spruce, be absolutely certain that your cap strips come square in all dimensions around there. I once bought, and I've still got the box of it out there, a whole bunch of that, and not one cap strip was cut square. So make sure that they're all cut square, and their dimension lumber may not quite be 1/4, or it could be a little over 1/4, or it could be flat out 1/4. It just depends on who's cutting that lumber that day. So you will lay out your jig using your dimension lumber to lay this out. And when we get to laying out a jig, I'll show you what I mean. All right, now we're ready to start laying in our diagonals. And the trick that I wanted to show you, it's a little tip, but you'll do this if you're building a wooden fuselage or even a steel tube fuselage for that matter. This is how you're going to lay your uprights and diagonals together. You'll take your center line of your uprights and extend it down to the center line of your cap strip. Same way up here. Center line to center line. Now we're going to connect those two center lines down here where they meet with the center line of our proposed diagonal. Now what that does for you is it puts your structural members aligning on one common point. But you do what the designer tells you to do. I know with the pits, they do it a little bit different. But I think pits, he does that on his wing ribs and his fuselage. But I think he does that to get a bigger footprint to carry the load. But he will come in. For instance, Curtis Pitts, the way he did his was he would lay it in like this. So they're not meeting on a common point, but it does, what that does for you is spread the load just a little bit. But it's not, it doesn't bring it in to a central point. And if your designer doesn't mention it or doesn't call it out, do it like this. This is the preferred method. I think even EA AC 43131A and 2, I think, calls out to do it that way. I'm pretty sure they do. So we're going to get our dimensions and draw our cap strip in. And then I'll lay out the rest of these diagonals off camera because it's just redundant. Also, there are some designers, I've seen them do this and I don't agree with it. I think the Legal Eagle does it this way, but you're playing with an ultralight, so, you know, your loads aren't going to be that extreme. They will come in on the Legal Eagle, and he'll just bring his cap strip in without forming his cap strip to conform to the joint. He'll just bring it in and just lay it in squared off like that and leave that big old gap right there. On an ultralight you can do that, but, and I'm not going to talk bad about that designer. He apparently knows what he's doing, but on anything else, do it like this. It's when you make those cuts, make them as perfect as you can get them to lay in there. So we've got the rib laid out for the most part, except for that little nose block up there. And we'll lay lay that out momentarily. And then once that is done, then we can take all of this apart and start building our jig. So I've got the nose block drawn in. Boy, I don't like that at all. I just don't like it at all. But that's the way they designed it. They had two designs. This is the alternative design. The first one was just a little dinky thing right there with a half-inch nose block in it. This is more substantial, but I still don't like it. They're saying to build it out of spruce or mahogany. I guess you could use quarter-inch mahogany plywood there, too. So I'm going to study that a little bit and see what I want to do. And this is probably going to wrap it up for this video. And the next one, we'll pick it up where we're building the actual rib jig. So as always, fellas, I sure appreciate you watching. Thanks a lot.